Yes, good morning once again. It is the Overcomer Show right here on Kofifi 97.2, where it all began. And we are overcomers through Christ who loved us. Yesterday, we spoke about overcoming the world. Three components where the Word of God, Jesus wants us to be overcomers in three areas of our lives. Overcoming the world was the first one where we spoke about yesterday, how to overcome the world, the cosmos, the world that we live in, the environments and all the other business worlds, the world system basically. And today we are talking about overcoming the flesh. The flesh. Die vlees is altyd gewillig, maar die gees wil eintlik hê ons moet daar so wees, maar die vlees kom altyd in die pad in. So this morning, beloved brothers and sisters, we are talking about overcoming the flesh. And what is the flesh? The flesh is the carnal mind, the carnal body. You know, a lot of times we have fits of carnality. And a lot of times we want to do something. When Paul writes in Philippians and or in Ephesians, he says, the things that I want to do, I don't do, and the things that I shouldn't do, I find myself doing. So that is the enmity, the war between the natural man and the spiritual man. And we must clearly remind ourselves, brothers and sisters, that we are a spirit being, because God says that we that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. So we are not a fleshly being. The flesh that you see on our bodies is just our body suit, but we are a spirit being, and God is spirit, and those that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. So that's why we cannot have a situation where we can train the flesh. We cannot train the flesh, because the flesh is enmity with God. The flesh is the enemy that God says that, hey, you know what? You cannot have a spiritual experience while you are training your flesh. So the spirit man needs to be fed. The Bible clearly tells us that although our outward man, which is the flesh, is perishing, our inward man, which is the spirit, is being renewed day by day. So the emphasis is always on feeding the spirit. When we get born again, the Bible clearly tells us that we receive the Holy Spirit through adoption. The Holy Spirit comes and we receive and we get baptized in the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit then, the new life, the dunamis, the power of God basically comes and lives in us. And it's through the Holy Spirit, the spirit man, that the power is released in our lives. So a lot of times we want to do a spiritual thing through a fleshly experience. And we cannot do that, because the flesh clearly is an enemy of God. Have you ever heard yourself that you want to try and break a habit? A lot of times we want to try and break a habit in the flesh. But the flesh cannot break the habit. You have a habit of overeating. So the flesh cannot break that habit, because once the flesh starts smelling food and seeing food, then the flesh starts, you know, gravitating towards that food, and it becomes covetousness. It becomes the drug lekker, and you will let meer kos eat. So we cannot break habits with the flesh, because and the flesh cannot be trained, you know, to have a Christian life. Unfortunately, we cannot train our bodies to have a Christian life. Paul writes it clearly, is that, you know, when we train, we also need to have spiritual exercise. And the spiritual exercise is that we need to exercise our spiritual muscles. Did you know, beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, that faith is a spiritual muscle? Hope is a spiritual muscle. All the fruits of the spirit are spiritual muscles. You know, gentleness, loving kindness, patience, and all those things. And those are spiritual muscles that develops through the Holy Spirit. And it's the fruit of that Holy Spirit that comes to life. So the flesh cannot please God. Why do we say that the flesh cannot please God? Because the scripture tells us, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the spirit, the things of the spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is an enemy against God. For it is not subject to the law of God. It means it's not subject to the word of God. Neither indeed can it be. So that they that are in the flesh cannot please God. And that scripture comes from Romans 8 verses 5 to 8. So we clearly see that the flesh cannot please God. The flesh, secondly, wars against the spirit. And the scripture there is 1 Peter 2 verse 11. Dearly beloved, I beseech you. Well, you must understand when Paul writes beseech. Beseech is a very strong worded phrase, because beseech him, he says, I want to arrest you. You must pay attention to this. I admonish you. I want to bring this to attention. He says, dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and as pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. So the flesh is always warring against our soul. And the enemy, we must remember that the enemy is after our soul. He wants to fight us at all cost. That's why the flesh and the spirit. So it's the natural man with the spiritual man. The spiritual man will, if we feed the spiritual man, we will gain more power. But if we feed the natural man, our appetites for lusts, our appetites for covetousness, for hatred, all these other things that wars against the spirit, that will come big. So because the more we give attention to something, it will grow. Now, can you imagine if you give attention to eating more? Can you imagine if you give attention to hating more people, to be envious to more people? What does it do? The flesh grows, and that flesh basically becomes a bigger force in one's life, and then the spirit man is subdued. Because at the end of the day, we must rather exercise our spiritual man so that our spiritual man can always be superior against the natural man. And here's the thing that I want to pose today, because a lot of times we want to see the external things happen first. But a lot of times we must understand as believers in Christ that all our battles are fought in the spiritual realm. Because the Bible clearly tells us that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against principalities, spiritual wickedness in dark places. So all of those hostile powers, as we have previously said, happens in a spiritual world. Because we are spirit, so the battle takes place in the atmospheres. You know, a lot of times we see things manifest in the natural because it is the result of what happened in the spiritual realm. And a lot of times we must understand that the battle, beloved brothers and sisters, we are in a real battle. And the flesh is fighting against the spirit. And we must always make sure that when we feed our spirit, that our spirit man is well equipped with the word of God, because that's how we feed the spirit. We feed the spirit, our spirit man, with the word of God. The spirit has the power. The spirit of God listens to God's word. It gets activated. The spirit is voice activated only through the word of God. The spirit will not be activated through any word that is a fleshly word. So in other words, when I say to my spirit that hate that person, my spirit will not respond to that. If I tell my spirit man, love that person, then the spirit will gravitate towards that person, because that spirit man is at peace and in harmony with God's word. God's word, as we explained yesterday, is the exousia, the authority. So the Holy Spirit can only act upon the authority of God's word. And he lines itself up with the word. And the word then produces the power. And the power comes from the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. We're talking about the Holy Spirit. It's not an experience, it's a person. The Holy Spirit is a person that is evident because we serve a Trinity God, the Father God, Father Son, and Father Holy Spirit. That is the threesome: the Holy Spirit, Father God, Father Son, and Father Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is voice activated only, and it reacts on the Word of God. So that's why the flesh wars against the Spirit, because the flesh doesn't want us to do spiritual things. A lot of times we know that if a person comes to us and that person is in need and we have money or we have food to give that person, the flesh will tell us, Nema, wat gaan word van jou? What's going to happen to you? So that is the flesh speaking. But the Spirit will, the Spirit man will tell you something else, because the Spirit man is lined up with the will of God. You see, the will of God is God's word. And the word of God will always tell us to do the right thing. The Holy Spirit is a person that doesn't convict you of wrong. There's nothing wrong in the Holy Spirit. There is no fault in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will only convict us of what is right, because the Holy Spirit will tell us what to do and when to do it and how to do it. Now, our flesh cannot fight a spiritual war as well. And I want to take our beloved brothers and sisters back to the sons of Sceva. The story in Acts 19 verse 15. Do you remember? They went into the house to cast out a demon from a man, the sons of Sceva. And then the demon said, "Ha! Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but Vish Yella, where do you guys come from? Who are you?" Because they were trying to go and drive out a demonic spirit with a fleshly attitude. And that's why we cannot fight spiritual battles with flesh. We cannot go and fight spiritual battles with a carnal mind, because the carnal mind is enmity with God. The demon said, "Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you?" Then the man ran out of the house naked. It is no good, people, to try and fight a demon or demonic or spiritual or wicked power with a fleshly attitude. Now allow me to share 12 spiritual weapons that I personally have found that can also help us. Spiritual weapons, remember, God's word is our spiritual weapons, but there are a lot of spiritual weapons in the Bible, in the Word of God. But let me share them with you, and there are 12 that I just want to share with you today. The first one is the Word of God, and it's according to Ephesians 6 verse 17. The second one is mediation, according to Isaiah 26 verse 3. The third one is revelation knowledge, according to Daniel 11 verse 32. The fourth one is the prayer of faith, once again, according to Ephesians 6 verse 16. And then the fifth one is to praise, to have praise, according to Psalm 149 verse 6 to 9. The sixth one is using the name of Jesus Christ. It's a spiritual weapon, according to Mark 16, 17 to 18. And then the seventh one is the blood of Jesus Christ, according to Revelations 12, verse 11. The eighth one is a submitted life to God. And here is a lot of times that we don't submit our lives to God. We submit our lives to God on a Wednesday, and then we forget about Him again on a Friday. The ninth one is goes together with the submitted life to God. It means an obedience to God. The submitted life to God is according to James 4 verse 7. The obedience to God is according to Deuteronomy 28 verses 1 to 7. The 10th one is to have a pure conscience, according to 1 Timothy 1 verse 18. And the 12th one is the fullness of Jesus Christ, according to Zechariah 4 verse 6. Now, we must understand there are a lot of consequences when we try to have a flesh battle instead of a spiritual battle. Because the consequences is that we will end up being more resentful. We will end up more hateful when we fight flesh battles. Have you ever seen when you want to contest someone and be physical with someone, you feel more worse. As a believer in Christ, and when the Holy Spirit dwells in us and the Holy Spirit guides us and leads us continuously, have you ever felt that when you want to, you know, you will iemand te hande kom, you will om te lewe gaan, and you get into a physical battle, it actually gets worse. You feel worse because we cannot engage the enemy with a flesh attitude, with a body fight, with a fist fight, because it doesn't work. The Bible clearly tells us that we cannot serve two masters at the same time. We're either going to serve the world or we're going to serve Jesus Christ. And we need to fight the enemy with our weapons, because the enemy is a fool. And once the enemy, we all know he's a fool, but he will drag us into his arena and he will beat us with his own weapons of flesh, because we as a spirit man, as a spirit being, cannot win against the enemy when we fight him in the fleshly realm. We must bring the enemy into the spiritual realm, and we must defeat him with our spiritual weapons that I've mentioned now. The spiritual weapons that is available to us through the Word of God and through the power and the working of the Holy Spirit. And that is the only time that we will have a surpassing victory. We all know the example of David and Goliath. But do you all know that the battle was first won in the spiritual realm? The battle was won in the spiritual realm first, before it manifested on the field in the valley of Elah, where David actually defeated Goliath. And all of us, we need to have spiritual preparation. We need to have spiritual exercise. Because when we encounter the enemy, where do we run to? Do we first want to run to the flesh, or do we want to basically say, how am I going to work it out? How am I going to do this? Maybe I must do this and I must do that. But we need to go to the Word. We must ask the Holy Spirit to guide us and to give us revelation knowledge, to show us. You know, when we go to do war, and we do go to the army and we fight the enemy like in a real thing, there's a battle plan. But that battle plan is first, it's the rules of engagement. We must know our enemy. How does our enemy going to react if I attack him from the left side? How is he going to react when I attack him from the right side? But we need to know our enemy, the rules of engagement, because at the end of the day, we cannot go and fight him if we are not prepared. And God clearly tells us in the Bible that our fight, we don't wrestle with flesh and blood. We wrestle against spiritual wickedness, spiritual powers, and rulers of dark places. So I want to encourage you today, beloved brothers and sisters, that it's very important that God clearly tells us we cannot train our flesh. We cannot train our flesh. We need to exercise our spirit. 1 Timothy 4 verse 8 clearly tells us, when Paul writes, and he tells Timothy, because Timothy was mentored by Paul. And as we speak the Word of God, and as we mentor you by means of radio and the airwaves, this is what Paul told Timothy in 1 Timothy 4 verse 8. He said, "For bodily exercise profit little, but godliness is profitable unto all things." Now, it clearly tells us that to exercise godliness is much more profitable than bodily exercise. Having promise of the life that is now and that is which to come. Because when we have a godly exercise, if we exercise the Word of God, if we train ourselves up in the Word, if we train our children up in the way of the Lord, when they are old, they shall not depart from it. And when we train ourselves and we exercise godliness, and then it will profit our soul. Because if we don't exercise godliness and we just exercise on the physical training, then we become fleshly stronger, but spiritually weaker. And it's important. I would rather, I always make the statement, I will rather have a very strong spirit instead of a strong body. Because I always see these big muscles. You know, people go to gym and they do a six-pack. Sometimes they get an eight-pack. I can never get to that pack. So I only get to a three pack. But I would rather have a strong spirit. I will exercise my spirit, because I know the spirit man is superior to the natural man. And this morning I want to encourage you to have godly exercise, beloved brothers and sisters, because when we exercise that, when we exercise godliness, we become so much stronger. I don't know, but I've experienced it in my life. A lot of times I feel weak. When I actually go and do a lot of physical training, I feel more weaker. And when I'm away from the Word, it makes me weaker. And when I get into the Word, because the Word then gives us strength. You know, Paul writes, he says, when we are weak, He who is the Holy Spirit is strong in us and through us. So this morning, I want to encourage you, my beloved brothers and sisters, is that the flesh profit nothing. You know, we cannot rely on the flesh, because even the Bible says, do not put your trust in the arm of flesh, because we trust people. A lot of times we don't run to God. We don't come to God and says, God, I trust you. But I will rather trust a Peter. I will trust a Paul. If Paul disappoints us, and then we lose hope. But Jesus never disappoints, because Jesus always delivers. He is faithful. He said, my promises are yes and amen. And this morning, I don't want us to focus and have our trust in the arm of flesh, because the flesh always fails us. Jesus clearly says that you cannot train the flesh, and the flesh is my enemy. So this morning, my beloved brothers and sisters, as we conclude this morning, tomorrow morning, we'll be speaking about overcoming the enemy. Today, we spoke about overcoming the flesh. The flesh profits nothing. We need to make sure that God's will, which is His Word, and the Holy Spirit that lives in us works hand in hand. You know, we know the famous Psalm 23, where David writes, he says, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, in the Hebrew context of rod and staff, it means rod is God's Word, and the staff is God's Holy Spirit, because God's Word and His Holy Spirit always work in tandem. It cannot work outside of one another. It has to work in tandem, because the authority is there through the Word, and the power is there through the Holy Spirit to exercise and to make that Word come to life. So this morning, as I conclude, I want to leave you with an Ecclesia moment. And I hope that you have found it very meaningful this morning. Because for me, it's also very insightful. Every time when I encourage you, I also get encouraged. And it's for me an honor and a privilege to share God's Word. Because a lot of times we think that, how am I going to apply God's Word in my life? And it's the application of God's Word. It's very simple. And sometimes we get people that complicate God's Word. And I hope that, you know, if there's any, you want to see clarity, if there's any other questions that you need, please do not hesitate and phone our officer so that we can give you the notes. The notes are free. It will also be on our YouTube channel very soon that we will be streaming live. So please feel free. We are here to equip the saints and to make sure that we develop one another's faith free of charge. No, we not charge anything, because God's Word is free. Amen. So I want to leave you with the Ecclesia moment for this Wednesday. It says that if the storm forgets to bring our rainbow, let us paint our own rainbow. Isn't that wonderful? You know, a lot of times when the storms that comes in our lives, and we go through all of these deluge of rain and winds and snow, those are storms, the troubles of lives and everything. But every cloud has a silver lining. But if the storm doesn't bring us a rainbow, because who knows, every time after a storm, there's a rainbow. But this nugget says that if the storm doesn't bring us that rainbow, we must paint our own rainbows. So today I want to just, and tomorrow and in the weeks to come, I want to encourage you, stay strong, be an overcomer, study the Word of God, And do not let the flesh rule and reign in your life. We are spirit because God is spirit. And those that worship Him in spirit and in truth. Be blessed as you overcome this Wednesday, the 11th of January, 2017. In Jesus' name, amen.